first like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to present our data here. My talk actually has three parts. In the beginning, I'm going to talk about single-cell transcriptomics. Then I'll talk about spatial transcriptomics. Those two approaches use both Illumina sequencing and nanobulk sequencing. In the last part of my talk, I present data that were only done with nanobulk sequencing to show you that Illumina sequencing is not really necessary anymore. Most approaches for single-cell transcriptomics use emulsions to co-encapsulate cells and barcoded beads into droplets. The cDNA is synthesized there. You end up with barcoded cDNA. Those primers on the beads contain also a short random sequence called UMI. UMI stands for Unique Molecular Identifier, and those are short barcodes that tag cDNA molecules. They are a very, very important feature for single-cell sequencing, since you tag each cDNA molecule with a unique ID. Normally, a single cell just contains a few hundred femtograms of mRNA. If you amplify this to prepare libraries, and if you count reads in the end, you get amplification bias. If you use UMIs, you can merge reads that belong to the same UMI, and you finally count cDNA molecules. You get rid of the amplification bias. On top of this, UMIs allow the generation of consensus sequences for RNA molecules. You can do error correction, and that's highly interesting for nanopore sequencing. Normally, single-cell libraries, transcriptome libraries, are sequenced on Illumina sequencers. Since your cell barcode is at one extremity, and you need to fragment your cDNA, you end up with terminal sequences. It looks like in the old days of transcriptomics, where people did SAGE sequencing. You lose most of the info on splicing and SNVs. There's actually a pretty easy solution. Just skip the fragmentation and do nanobulk sequencing, and you get the entire sequence. That's actually the easy part. The more difficult part is to identify those UMIs and barcode sequences. Because a single-cell experiment typically uses 1,000 or more cells, each cell has thousands of UMIs, and especially identifying those short UMI sequences can be pretty tricky. This is why we were using an approach that uses high-accuracy Illumina data to guide cell barcode and UMI assignment. We first extract barcode UMI combos from Illumina data, and then for each nanopore read, we search for matching barcode UMI combinations in the Illumina data for the same gene or genomic regions. Since we require both to match the UMI and the barcode, it's highly accurate. Our barcode assignment accuracy is 99.8%, the UMI accuracy is 97%. Nanopore sequencing of single-cell libraries gives you isoform expression information. I show here one example. It's myosin light chain in mouse brain. Illumina sequencing just yields gene expression data. Nanopore sequencing reveals an isoform switch of there's one myosin light chain isoform that's mainly expressed in precursors, the other one in mature neurons. Such information you miss if you do Illumina sequencing. Nanobulk sequencing also allows to identify single nucleotide variations. The main SNV that you find in mouse brain transcriptomes is editing. I show here one example. It's editing of the AMPA receptor CRIA2. Those are two UMIs from the same cell. One is clearly edited, and the one in the bottom is non-edited. Using UMIs makes it much clearer. If you have a situation where, let's say, 10% of the transcript of a transcript in a cell is edited, if you see 10% cheese in your reads, you always doubt sequencing errors. If you use UMIs, it gets clear. So you don't need just to know in which cell a transcript is expressed, you also want to know in which part of a tissue it's expressed. There are lots of techniques around for spatial transcriptomics, and every year a couple of new ones come out. Most are based on in situ hybridization. Some use in situ sequencing, and others use in situ cDNA synthesis. We were seeking for an approach that would allow to obtain spatially resolved full-length sequence information. And to me, the most promising approach appeared to be the 10x Genomics Visium system. This system uses spatially barcoded primers created on the slides. The tissue section is permeabilized on the slide. cDNA is synthesized there. After sequencing, you get spatial gene expression information. Those spatially barcoded cDNAs look actually quite similar to the single-cell cDNA. Only the cell barcode is replaced by a spatial barcode. So we could use our barcode urinary assignment strategy that we used for single-cell transcriptomics also for spatial transcriptomics. If we do this, we obtain also spatially resolved isoform expression information. Here's one example. It's PLP1 in the mouse olfactory bulb. They're one of the two isoforms. It's mainly expressed in the inner layers of the olfactory bulb, the other one mainly in the outer layers. The Visium system has a rather low resolution. The spots are 50 micrometers in diameter. But it's a good system to explore a tissue for changes. Then you can refine those by using a higher resolution technique. We use here in situ sequencing. This nicely confirms this isoform switch. So the transcript coverage looks rather good. There's a pretty nice 5' coverage. There's some decrease towards the 5', which is mainly due to some degradation during permeabilization. But you obtain far more 5' information than with the Illumina data. Since we have full-length sequencing information, we can also analyze SNVs. Here, we analyzed the A2i editing level in mouse brain for 100,000 editing sites. The data show that the highest editing level is in the thalamus, and the lowest one is in the fiber tract. And this nicely correlates with the expression level of the editing enzyme, ADA. ADA is highly expressed in the thalamus and it's very low in fiber tracts. So how many reads do we need for such an experiment? The mouse olfactory bulb is pretty tiny. If we just wanted to transcript isoform discovery, something around 30 million reads is fine for such an experiment. If you want to call SNVs, you want to have each UMI sequenced several times. You need a much higher sequencing depth. In this case, something between 50 and 70 million reads are fine. For brain sections, which are much bigger, you need something around 100 million reads for isoform discovery and closer to 200 million reads for SNV calling. So until now, we used Illumina and nanopore reads for single-cell transcriptomics and spatial isoform transcriptomics. Would be better just to skip Illumina, right? The Illumina data completely. Nanopore reads got much better during the past 2 years, and now it's actually easily possible to assign barcodes by clustering, since there are several thousand reads for each cell barcode. We do this now by clustering, others do it also, but the tough part is assigning the UMIs. I'm going to talk about this later. What we actually do currently, we take the nanopore reads, we split chimeric reads. That's about 1 to 4% of the total read number. Those are mainly formed during LSKEY 109 library preparation. Then we search for poly-A tails, an intact transcript, a correct transcript, mRNA. cDNA should have a poly-A. We lose about 20% of the reads. Those are mainly PCR artifacts that were generated during the 10x genomics workflow. Next step, we search for adapters. We lose about 5% of the reads. We don't care of those because those are mainly low-quality reads. Then we extract barcode sequences and we assign barcodes by clustering. We actually do two passes here. In the first pass, we only use very high-quality reads and we use them to define the used barcodes. In the second pass, we assign barcodes. It's always, barcode assignment, it's always a trade-off between accuracy and efficiency. For us, a good compromise appears allowing an edit distance of 1. It gives a very high barcode assignment accuracy and still a decent efficiency. We recover about 58% of the reads. With Illumina data, for the same data set, it's 80%. If you do a single-cell transcriptome sequencing experiment with Illumina sequencing, the software, 10x Genomics software, kicks out a barcode rank plot. And this one gives important quality information. I show here an example. Those are cells from a nasal airway brushing of a COVID-19 patient. And in this experiment, there were some smaller or likely leaky cells over here. In the top, cells with lots of UMIs are mainly intact cells. Here are partially leaky cells. If we do the same thing with nanopore reads, we get something quite similar. A gradual decrease here, and the cutoff was 3,026 cells because we had far less reads here. Those two data sets overlap nicely. 2,800 barcodes are in common, and those who are not in common concern mainly barcodes that are close to the cutoff, so cells with very few reads or UMIs. The challenge is the UMI assignment. We need to assure that related UMIs are grouped, but we also need to minimize grouping of non-related UMIs. The strategy we are currently using is we take the genome-matched, barcode-assigned nanopore reads, we extract post-barcode sequences, so the UMI candidates, and then we cluster UMIs for the same cell, but also only for the same genomic region, and we allow an edit distance of 2. So we actually cluster UMIs that belong to the same gene. And typically, in a single cell, the copy number for one gene is, for most transcripts, below 10. So if a UMI is in a cluster, we assign the sequence of the cluster center as UMI. If it's not in a cluster, we just assign the sequence as UMI. If you have Illumina data available, we plug them in. So we first do the Illumina-dependent search. If we don't find it, we go back to the clustering and we assign the UMI. The data I'm showing here is all done without Illumina data. Normally, the correlation between the UMIs per cell should be well between the Illumina and nanopore data, and this is the case here. There's a very good correlation in the number of UMIs per cell between both data sets. Correlation of gene expression. If we look at the bulk, the sum of all the cells, it looks nice, but there are some outliers. And that's always the case if you compare Illumina gene expression data with nanobot gene expression data, because Illumina has some mapping issues that short reads are mapped to several genes. Nanopore has some mapping issues with Minimap 2, that the extremity of the read is mapped to another transcript. So it looks like a normal correlation between nanopore and Illumina transcriptome data. If you look at the correlation for single cells, it's somewhat lower. And this is normal, because in single cells, your number of counts are much lower. You have more dropouts. If you compare both data sets, so Illumina, we had far more reads. Normally, 10x Genomics recommends to generate about 30,000 reads per cell. The Illumina data with 72,000 reads per cell were actually over-sequenced. Nanopore sequencing was with 9,000 reads per cell, rather shallow. And in consequence, there are less genes identified and less UMIs. So, but despite this shallow sequencing, okay, what we used here was just one Prometheum flow cell, and this was not an optimal one. And despite this shallow sequencing and not optimal sequencing depth, nanopore sequencing identifies correctly the cell types in the sample. The clustering looks rather similar to the one obtained with high-depth Illumina data. So how many reads do we need to do single-cell transcriptome sequencing with nanopore sequencing? If you do just a transcriptome profiling, 1 to 2 flow cells should be enough for 1 to 2,000 cells. If you want to call SNVs, we want to sequence each UMI several times. So we need a higher sequencing depth. In this case, we would need 4 to 6 flow cells. There's another alternative to do a shallow sequencing for transcriptome profiling and to add a targeted sequencing for genes of interest to increase their sequencing depth. So in conclusion, both accurate single-cell and spatial transcriptomics with nanopore sequencing is feasible. And I think Illumina sequencing is meanwhile optional. We're going to move more and more to nanopore-only sequencing. So the most of this study was done in Pascal Barbery's lab in Nice. And Kevin Lebrigon did most of the analysis of the data. The Visium study, the spatial transcriptomics, was done in collaboration with Joachim Lundeberg's lab in Stockholm. Thank you, and I'm happy to take questions.